Hey, what's going on, guys? Just want to give you guys a quick origin on the song The Bright Side and all the cool factors of importance that kind of come along with a great song like this. Now, the song does currently sit at a whopping 74 million views on Peep's official channel. The first really cool thing that we kind of have to highlight here is the fact that Peep was alive and well way before he passed this video was published. So that has to let you know and respect the fact that he chose this version of the video himself. He shot a video with Paul John, which is an amazing video, and it really gives you a perfect amount of insight into how good he was as an artist standing in front of a cinematography lens. He was really good. That video has really cool, epic shots, but the fact that Gus isn't here, and the fact that we lost him, it makes that video so much more special. And when you view that snippet of the other alternate video, you embrace it a little bit more because it has all these elements of a person we love so much no longer here. And when you see something rare like that, it really is a profound outlook, and it's kind of an initial glance that you wouldn't have if you looked at that video under a different circumstance. So by pairing the videos together now, of course the Paul John one will seem cooler because it's rarer, it's more exclusive, it's unreleased, and it just has all these really cool unreleased rare elements to it that are really an eye-opener for any kind of fan who embraces an artist that's no longer here. Or even if he was here, it's just cool to find something that is not an everyday find, a rare gem, an exclusive search result. It's always kind of exciting. But we have to understand the fact that if Peep went with the video that Mezzy and Wiggy did, it's only based off the fact that it includes more of a deluxe variety of footage, from Peep being on airplanes, to touring Europe, to interacting with his beloved audience. So at the end of the day, I think Peep only selected this video because it just included a wider virage of him and what it was like to be a full-time musician and to be the name billed as Lil Peep. I think he just wanted to give fans a window into his personal life as an artist. So with that said, I still think he has the same exact level of appreciation and love for the video he did with Paul. I just think he liked the second video, and we have to respect that because, like I said, this video came out way before Pete passed away untimely, so we have to understand that he's the one who uploaded this video with his management team. So he had final say in the videos they were using, and he picked this video. He still continued to work with Paul after that. Obviously, you guys know that Paul did a slew of videos for Peep. He did Backseat, he did The Night Peep Came Back, he did Hellboy, and he did Brightside. So he really did do a lot of work with Paul. Paul has a great portfolio, by the way, too. He is a very serious cinematographer. And if I'm correct, he doesn't believe in what he does as music videos. He actually calls them films. So if an artist ever tries to contact him and ask him for a music video, he will reply and say, "I'm sorry, but I don't do music videos. I only do films." So he takes his craft very serious. But at the end of the day, we can't think any less of the video that Paul did just because Peep went with Wiggy and Mezzy's video. Like I said, I just think it came down to a hair factor of Peep making the final choice because it included a bigger variety of himself inside the video for his fans to see what it's like to be not only a marquee name, but to be a touring musician with a crazy fan base. But I feel bad for Paul because he has all these videos, and every time he tries to upload one, he gets a strike on his channel. But anyways, guys, at the end of the day, Gus was a hell of a spokesperson for a generation. But it was a song like Brightside that was his message to the people. Let's get into this beautiful video, and let's cover the second single off the timeless, unforgettable debut album, Come Over When You're Sober.
Brooklyn.
I give her Dick Sham, man. Gotta keep my focus up phenomenal. Once I cock and load on the money, man. Got a hundred
holes, got a hundred cents. Living more or less my dream. They will not forget about me. I got all these toes on me. But I only want my ex. So I drown my pain in sex.
What's going on, Goth Gang? I want to welcome all you guys to episode 2 of Glo Behind The Show. Now, before I kind of walk down the rampway like Austin when that glass breaks and all the hairs on the back of your neck stand up and he does that badass strut down the walkway and you know what, he fucking throws his leg in through them ropes and starts doing that strut and them turnbuckles and smashing those bears together. What I mean, guys, is we're about to take part in a badass celebratory moment. But it's not going to be of winning the WWF title or handing out a really cool stunner to Kane and Undertaker or hitting fucking our boss in the head with a chair. It's going to be putting a magnifying glass on some of these really cool moments from Peep's artistic timeline. He was a guy that really had a sea of fans. Man, do you guys remember Woodstock 94? I don't know how old some of my audience is, but if you guys are kind of in the age bracket near me, Rolling Loud, by today's standard, is kind of a modern facility of what Woodstock 94 used to be. Can you imagine if they brought Woodstock back? If you were booked for Woodstock, man, you were a sizzling hot band at the time. So I really think they should consider bringing those events back. I know Lollapalooza still goes on and they kind of have like the Coachella, but there was nothing like Woodstock. But anyways, I just think that would have been so cool to see Pete be able to play Woodstock. Holy fuck, man. Can you picture the Hellboy intro and then that fucking Under Oath riff building up with the smokeasac drums and then Peep coming out and doing the first verse to Hellboy? Oh my god. But anyways, let's get into this banger. So for episode 2, Peeps Come Over When You're Sober luxury stage tour bus pulled into the legendary parking lot of the Shelter in Detroit. Now, before Peep steps foot on this classic, legendary gravel parking lot and walks to the back door of the VIP entrance to go headline a gig at the legendary Shelter, can you imagine the excitement that was flowing through your boy's veins that night? Oh my god, guys, he probably had butterflies in his stomach the whole ride to Michigan because Peep knew his music. He was a fan of Pac, he was a fan of the Chili Peppers, he was a fan of Nirvana, he was a fan of Blink-182. He loved all kinds of music, guys, and he really followed. Oh shit, my stomach just beeped because I got some tacos cooking. Hold on, you know how Goth Boi does it. We do everything in one take, baby. We don't do no edits here. But anyways, I had to set another reminder so I don't fucking burn my house down doing a goddamn Goth Boi video. What the fuck? How am I going to upload a video if my fucking whole house is fucking burned down? But anyways, guys, can you imagine how excited Pete was when he fucking pulled up to that venue, man? Oh, because you know he knew the history. The fact that Eminem and all the guys from D12, Dirty Dozen, were battling in the same place 30 years ago. Man, that place just has some really cool, classic, legendary vibes to it. So I could just imagine how excited not only Pete, but GBC were. I don't know, guys. This has to be one of the most shows that isn't talked about, but really should be, because Pete put on an incredible performance in Detroit. You guys really like that montage video as I did of Pete's live vocal range. If you guys go back to that video, I closed it out with Peep doing the Brightside in Detroit, and that's exactly what we're going to do today, because this was such an important performance, and really, if it's one thing Peep did when he got on stage that night in Detroit, instead of plugging the microphone into the PA, he plugged it directly into his chest, and what I mean by that is he sang every song from his fucking heart. Really, I mean, his voice sounded so good, guys. The only concert I could think of where his voice sounded if not a little better here, was in Boston. Peep in Boston, like, shortly before he passed away, is probably the best vocal performance you can find on YouTube. I know a lot of guys are real big on Rolling Loud, and don't worry, we'll cover that concert. We'll make sure that we rock that baby to sleep. We'll make sure that we take care of that one. But for now, you guys have to check out all the film you can find on Boston, because I promise you, you will not be disappointed. He put on a hell of a vocal show in Boston. And it seems every time he went to Boston, he always gave the Boston fans a really good energetic set. So, much like Europe, I wonder if Peep has some kind of, attraction to Boston. I know he's a big pizza guy, and I know New York and Chicago and Boston are kind of known for their pizza. Obviously, I'm being funny here, but who knows if somehow maybe a slice of pepperoni does tie into Peep's legendary sets at Boston. Who knows? It could be something as simple as that. Just Peep really enjoyed your pizza, so he made sure he played Needle a little harder. But anyways, let's get into this video, man. This is the night that Peep pulled up in Detroit, Michigan on the Come Over to Your Sober Tour, the final leg. And boy, was he getting ready to flip the curtain on a legendary stage. Peep looked really cool, too. He had just a pair of jeans on, a black t-shirt, and his hair was, like, perfect length. And, man, when they handed him his mic and he fucking put it up to his mouth and started going, I tell you guys, this is probably one of the best performances of this song you can find. Let's get into The Bright Side, live at The Shelter.
You going through my cell phone.